Are you working? What kind of work do you do?
It's the midweek podcast. He's Charlie Bornoff. I'm Will Connerly. We're breaking things down, Charlie. What week are we at now? Breaking down week number 5 of college baseball.
5, baby. We're back.
We've got winners and losers. And
a whole lot of them.
Weekend rotation, too, and then series picks. So a lot to get to here in D1 baseball. Week 5, like you mentioned. And I know one of your losers last week was March Madness and the fact that college baseball viewership was going to be down, but we're here to talk about anything that you may have missed over the weekend. And I want you to be up to the plate first, Charlie. Who's your first winner from this past weekend in college baseball?
Oh, that has to, it's easy. Probably we were talking about before the show. I think you would both agree actually that the biggest surprise in the SEC so far this year is the Missouri Tigers, our own home state, Missouri Tigers. Will, I have to apologize to Mizzou because I've been giving trouble all year. I've not really believed in the program the last couple of years, and I'd say deservedly so to an extent, but they really make me eat my words right now because the Tigers are on an absolute tear right now. They are coming off a massive series win, if you guys didn't see, against over number 2 Tennessee, where they held the whole pitching staff, by the way, is a sub win in this because the pitching staff held the whole Tennessee offense, which is one of the best in the country, to 5 runs on the year. And now Mizzou has improved to 16-3 on the year.
Very impressive from Mizzou. And I think when you break down the Tigers season, at least so far, a surprise is the correct word. Impressive is the correct word. But I remember after the first weekend, we said, okay, Mizzou's kind of turning heads.
Got some wins, yeah.
TCU in Texas, right?
Yep.
And then hanging there with Oklahoma State. And I thought that that turned some heads, but they've continued to play well. And now going up against Tennessee and doing what they just did, one of the best teams in the country, not just going toe-to-toe, but getting the brooms out against them. I think that they want to show that they're a force to be reckoned with now in the SEC. And I think the attention that they've got in the national polls is very representative of where they should be right now as a program. They're getting attention because they've been really good. And why they've been good, I think the pitching staff, Charlie, also the bullpen as well. There's some just guys in the bullpen on this team that is going to allow them to compete in SEC play at an extremely high level. I mean, some of the guys doing things out of the pen is just absurd right now.
Yeah, and to give you some numbers, I'm glad you said that, because to give you some numbers, I did some research. So all arms with 10 innings or more this year. So essentially the guys that, you know, you're rolling with week in and week out on these big series like a Tennessee, everyone with 10 innings pitched or more now have a sub-4 ERA. So that says a lot about, that's not only obviously the pitching staff, but like you said, the bullpen is coming up big. Mizzou's now ranked, what is it, 20th, right, in the country? Or 22nd?
Yeah, so it just depends what poll you go off of, but they're 22nd from D1 baseball.
Yeah, that's the one we always use. We love it. And then also, I'll let you say some more for sure. Mizzou has 8 guys hitting over 300 this year.
Yes, and they're hitting above 300 now as a team, which is very helpful when your team has a sub 3.5 ERA. As a team,
absolutely,
3.46. And they've just done a great job this year, kind of a Swiss Army knife type thing out of the pen for a guy like Zach Franklin, who's been around the block. It's like his 7th year of college baseball. He's doing unbelievable things. A married man, but 17 and a third innings, 3.6 ERA, he's throwing 97. And the starting rotation doesn't even have to be that great because the bullpen has guys who can provide length. And you love what like a guy like Austin Tresser can do. He got his first start, he got the start over this past weekend against Tennessee in part of that sweep. So he's a guy that's starting. Ian Losey, a guy who's starting. These names who are coming up, two products from the St. Louis area, along with Luke Mann, who are really big on this team, and they've just been so impressive. Obviously, Big Ross hitting 405. That's one of the most striking statistics thus far here for this team as well. But, man, really impressive. Love that Tigers pick. They really are balling to start the year. Looking forward to seeing what they can continue to do. I love that winner.
Oh, yeah.
So for my first winner, it's Miami. They got a big sweep over Virginia Tech.
Big time.
And they did some big things in the Saturday of the doubleheader. They played one of the two Saturday to finish the series. Scored 33 runs in the two games on Saturday combined. I think the Hurricanes made a statement, in my opinion, sweeping the 17th-ranked Hokies. They walked off in the ninth on Friday, then just absolutely mashed on Saturday. They hit seven home runs in a game on Saturday, the fourth most in a single game in program history. And then if it's a close game, well, we'll pull out Andrew Walters. He'll throw 98. So that's big. I know big CJ. Oh my gosh.
Big
Charlie,
CJ, baby. All-American pick.
You had Kafis on your All-American team, and for good reason. I think he's one of the hottest hitters in the country right now. At three home runs on Saturday. We're just talking Saturday, seven runs and nine at bats that he had on Saturday. Miami hit 10 home runs overall. I mean, it was a big time Saturday for Miami, but just big time weekend. Alex Rodriguez Park. I mean, they all looked like A-Rod this past weekend. They hit 451 as a team on Saturday. Walters hits 98. Miami's 14-6 and now 5-1 in ACC play after getting the sweep over Virginia Tech. So that is my first winner in Miami. Two teams that got big sweeps.
Yeah, that's a great pick. Miami's at the 17th now in the D1 baseball polls. Like you said, Kafis has been one of the best bats in all of baseball. I mean, you pair that with guys like Yo-Yo Morales and, you know, Andrew Walters coming out of the bullpen. Like, that's a recipe for success day in and day out.
It is. They've got some good guys, some experience, and they're going to be a force to be reckoned with in the ACC. That's a fact.
Absolutely. And speaking of success, I think you could argue no team has had more success this year than my next winner. And that's South Carolina. Gamecocks are now 20-1 on the year. 20-1. The only one loss in the year. They swept Georgia over the weekend. They're now tied for first in SEC play. Obviously, only one weekend, but, you know, still is good to get those wins out there in front, get them out of the way. Especially Georgia's got a really solid squad this year. To give you a couple of numbers though, on South Carolina, excuse me. Team's hitting .310 as a team, okay? They're the number one team in ERA in the SEC with a 2.57. They're also leading the SEC in homers with 56 on the year as a squad. So when you're leading, when you're limiting the most runs and you're blasting balls out of the park, it makes a whole lot of sense why you're 20-1.
Yeah, no team's been better so far from a record perspective, but they're also doing it in a way that's so dominant. And also, Charlie, still, like you mentioned, you feel like they still have room to improve because their best pitcher hasn't been their best pitcher.
No, Will Sanders has a 4.18 ERA on the year right
which
now,
which is the worst out of the weekend rotation so far. And they have, what, a sub-3 ERA as a team.
Sub 2.57.
That's unbelievable. They've been limiting runs at such a high level, blasting the ball out of the park. The Gamecocks are for real. When you talk about biggest surprise in SEC, this is one that you could potentially put in that conversation, right?
Oh, absolutely. We all knew they're gonna be good this year for sure, you know. But like, when you get out to a 20-1 start, like, that's just insane. You gotta talk about that kind of stuff.
Well, it's kind of like Tennessee last year. You know?
Yeah, exactly.
Similar. They haven't gotten to that point yet because Tennessee was what? I mean,
I remember.
We were late in the year, 37 and
three. Yeah. Got to really reach back in the memory bank for that one.
Yeah. Well, it's just last year.
Yeah.
Yeah. Memory.
Feels so long ago, though, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. Life changes. That's what Thomas said. So for me, I've got my second winner. Unless you were you done on South Carolina?
No, that's enough for me. We talked about him so many times this year. People know.
Well, people know, and they should. 21. But my second winner involves that team. So we're going to keep talking about him. But it's not just the SEC, and we always talk about him. But my second winner is that the four best win percentages in the country right now are teams from the SEC, the top four in the nation, not to mention it's the only conference in the country that's hitting above 300 as a conference. They're hitting 307 as a league, which is by far the best as a conference. We're talking about every single at bat that's taken by an SEC hitter this year. They're hitting 307 as a conference, which is best in the country. They have the four best win percentages in the country right now. South Carolina, like you just mentioned, Charlie, first in win percentage, and then Arkansas 18-2, Kentucky 18-2, LSU 18-2. That's all a 900 win percentage. That's the top four, and then ODU also with that same 18-2 record. not an SEC team, but has that 900 win percentage. So that's amazing. Kentucky just swept Mississippi State. They've won 14 in a row. Arkansas has won 13 in a row. And you got to give a little bit of clout to two teams on 13 and 14 game win streaks in Arkansas and Kentucky. And then also the fact that you have the top four win percentages right there. They're all have very, very good records. And I think that that's going to be interesting when you look at that continuing forward, because Arkansas, yeah, you understand it, but South Carolina and Kentucky now in that conversation along with LSU, all with great starts. We'll see if they can't keep it up. Probably not going to be able to do it at that pace in SEC action, but we'll see.
Yeah, it's a hard road, but also speak on the fact of the big success of the SEC this year. I mean, the worst record in the league right now, the two worst records are Mississippi State with 13-8 and Georgia in 13-7. Like, those are still pretty quality records, and like probably top four in a whole, like, you're probably top four in your conference with that kind of record in most other conferences. Just not the SEC though, because you got teams that are 20-1 still.
Right, and all that matters is league play at the end of the day. Yep. When you talk about postseason bids for your specific conference, but it's hard right now to think of what SEC team wouldn't make the NCAA tournament. Really, I mean. Yeah. I know that all of them, it's unlikely that every single one of them will make them, but could we see something kind of catastrophic where you're one of the two teams that doesn't make the SEC tournament and you still get some contention for the NCAA, or at least some looks, some first four outs? I don't know, but it's preposterous right now, because teams like South Carolina and Mizzou are kind of setting the tone. Kentucky are setting the tone along with the traditional powers of the Vanderbilts, the LSUs, the Arkansas. So that, I think that's why every weekend SEC baseball is much watch. If you're just a fan of baseball, and if you're a fan of college baseball, that's at its finest, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. It's going to be at the end of the year, there's gonna be some really good teams that aren't hosting a regional that should be in most other years. And there's gonna be some teams that are pretty good that aren't just going to be in the tournament at all coming from this conference.
Yeah, and that's the thing, hosting a region, you got to be one of the top teams in the country, top 16 seeds.
Yes,
and
sir.
Shoot, right now it's hard to know how many SEC teams are going to be in the top 16.
Yeah. So, RPI actually look great for all these teams, though.
Yeah, they all do look fantastic. So,
all right, my last winner is a team that you love quite a bit, and that's the Texas State Bobcats. Also Team USA superhero, Paul Goldschmidt's alma mater. All they did this weekend was they beat number 12 number 25 Southern Miss in their first Conference USA tournament. Conference? No, I'm tweaking. Anyways, they beat Southern Miss in conference rival. Big series win. Bobcats have now blasted 39 home runs on the year. The staff is led by Levi Wells, who has had a really quiet season in terms of like national coverage, but he's leading the team right now with an ERA of a 1.14 on the year. Like, that's what you want from your Friday guy.
Oh, he's been fantastic this year. I mean, been really, really good. I mean, this Texas State team overall, they drop game one of the series and then win game two, win game three. You start off conference play by doing some big things. I mean,
absolutely,
that's huge. And what conference? No. The Sun Belt.
Sun Belt. Yeah, I don't know why I said Conference USA. I was tweaking there.
No, you're all good. I mean, I like the Belt, man. The belt is
fun
nasty.
Belt, baby.
I mean, it really is. It's so much better this year with ODU and Troy and Texas State and Southern Miss. I don't know who's going to win the Sun Belt. The Raging Cajuns aren't a slump of a team. So that the Sun Belt is nasty. I'll tell you right now.
Belt is kind of like, you know how they always say the Big East is like the Power Six conference in basketball?
Mm-hmm.
I would call the Sun Belt the Power Five in baseball, just because of how bad the Big Ten is.
Yeah, and it's hard to, like, just to go on a tangent right now.
Yeah, go ahead, man. Cook.
Like, it's hard to call the Big East a Power Six, though, too, because you have Marquette, who was a 2 seed, Creighton, who was a 6 seed, Xavier, who was a 3 seed. Don't mention the traditional powers of Georgetown. And, oh, not to mention UConn was a top 10 team of the country at one point this year. Like, I don't know. Like, that was all. But, yes, Sun Belt is amazing.
Sun Belt has 4 teams with a losing record right now in the conference. That's it.
Pretty impressive. And Providence for basketball, too. But, like, still, like, that's just unbelievable to me. The Sun Belt has been very, very impressive overall. And I think that they need the respect, because you're right.
Yeah.
They're a Power Five type conference with how competitive they could be. And overall, I mean, Texas State is a force to be reckoned with. There's Absolutely. No doubt about that. My third winner, and also Chase Moore. He does cool things when he goes.
Yeah, he does some cool things.
Yeah. So okay. Vanderbilt is my next winner. And they had a 3-game sweep over number 3 Ole Miss. You know, you go Thursday, Friday, Saturday, you can get the brooms out against the reigning champs coming to town, who is a 3rd-ranked team in the country. You're doing good. The arms shove. They only allowed 4 runs over the weekend, doing some Mizzou-type stuff, what they did to Tennessee.
Yeah.
That's what Vandy did to Ole Miss. I think what Vandy did might have been more impressive because of the way Ole Miss was swinging the bats. I mean, they were just saying, we're not going to throw the ball effectively. We'll score 10 runs a game, though. And they were not able to do that against Vanderbilt's pitching staff. Carter Holton, dog. Hunter Owen,
dog.
Yeah, so it's like – those guys are good, and it's Vandy who ultimately is my third winner. Just a statement, really. I mean, you talk about statements in Nashville, like Tennessee did last year. Like, they put their own statement on Nashville with a sweep over the reigning champs in Ole Miss, and the pitching was just so good. I mean, going into that series, we said Vanderbilt, we recognized that Vanderbilt had an advantage in the starting pitching.
Yeah.
We just didn't
in the arms in general.
Right. And that ultimately was the difference. Ole Miss starting pitching wasn't great.
Yeah.
Vanderbilt's was fantastic. And it wasn't just their starting pitching. You know, as Aria mentioned last week, I mean, their bullpen is, they want to get to the pen.
Yeah.
They don't, like, some teams are like, we're going to get to your pen. But Vandy's like, no, we want to get to
our go pen. Ahead. Yeah. If you want to face Dave Maldonado, go ahead. By all means.
Yeah. 100. So, That's amazing. Vandy's my third winner.
Yeah, I'm kicking myself for not picking them last, because I'm usually I usually tend to go with, if I'm split on a team, whoever has the better pitching, I'm like, okay, that probably pays off. But I was really buying into the Ole Miss bats. But you know what happens?
It does.
You know, you catch an L sometimes.
Well, and it was very chilly. You know, I think that the Midwest weather was brutal this week as we started getting to losers. Let's just agree that was the first loser. So many games were canceled across the Midwest. Saw so many games in the Missouri, Illinois, Iowa area get moved from, you know, Saturday to like Sunday doubleheaders combined with a Monday game because it was so cold. It was below freezing across the Midwest. I mean, you talk about how Wofford was going to go to Xavier, and then Xavier said, no, we're going to Spartansburg. Like, there was so many series that had got shuffled around. So weather, let's agree that's our first loser. But before we dig into the losers, one more honorable mention winner. That's Kent State for me. They're on a 13 game win streak. They outscore their opponents 128 to 28 by 100 runs over their 8-game homestand. So got to give a shout out to that. It is a crazy number. So that is a shout out, but this is probably my favorite week of losers, Charlie. I don't know why, but
you just like it.
I found some, I at least so far throughout our podcasting history, which spanned over a year here in our second season on the Midweek Podcast, this week particularly, I found some very, very interesting losers this past week. And so I will get it going with UNC Greensboro, who just got swept by West Virginia, which was probably expected. West Virginia's been great. They're a team that's represented in the top 25 against the Spartans, who are 10-10 UNCG Greensboro, but they hail from the SoCon, which is a solid conference, Charlie, but it was a team that won 34 games a year ago. So they're like, we'll get to the point. They got swept by West Virginia. Well, here's the point, Charlie, I'm trying to make. They allowed 28 runs in their series opener. Oh, I mean, you're good talking God. 4 touchdowns in the series opener, 28-2 they lost. They got outscored 40-3 over the weekend. So UNC Greensboro is a quality team that was a 34-win team a season ago out of the SoCon, going up against a West Virginia team that I think is going to be a sleeper in the Big 12 this year with what Traxel's doing on the mound. Complete game every time out, baby. Yeah. But man, to be outscored 40-3, I mean, that's that L, you know, just counts as the losses on the loss column. But that L, I think, hurts a little larger. And that's my first loser.
Yeah, absolutely. That's definitely, it's getting your dick beat into the dirt right there. My first loser, mine are not nearly as abhorrent as yours are, but that was a great pick. I like that one a lot because that's a 40-3. Just
you say important?
One. No, abhorrent.
Abhorrent.
My first one, though, is talked about a little bit, but it's Tennessee getting swept by Mizzou. It's okay. Just a tough look when, no disrespect to Mizzou, but with Tennessee, reputation-wise, is the better baseball program in the last 5 years. They're still more talented, in my opinion. Still props to Mizzou no matter what. But it's just tough when, like, that's a series I think you go into, especially that I know Tennessee fans think, okay, this is supposed to be an easy series win for Tennessee, and you go down there and you drop that to them. And, I mean, nothing. I don't think there's anything to really panic about. You know, like Chase Dollander's ERA looks a lot worse than it really was, like you were saying before, because he's now at a 3.9, but that's really because of game one. But you just got to do better. It's just a tough look, kick in the gut, but it's something you got to bounce back from.
Yeah, I mean, Chase Dollander is a guy who sets the tone for them, and he didn't have a good outing, which is rare because he's the reigning SEC pitcher of the year, and he hadn't allowed more than two runs in any start this year. Mizzou hangs six on him, and his ERA looks a little bit different, still sub four.
It's a little funny. Yep.
But yeah, I mean, for Chase Dollander, a guy who you expect to go very early in the MLB draft, and that's the best rotation in the nation from a talent perspective. Everybody can in their rotation can throw above 97.
Yeah,
we talk about Chase Dollander, Drew Beam, and Chase Burns, but Mizzou did a great job. And you mentioned an easy win. But I'm saying they used to be. In the SEC, by many standards, they're not anymore, and they won't be an easy win for anybody. And I think that brought the attention of everybody that they deserve. So I like that one. And for another abhorrent loser, Charlie. For me, was that the correct usage of your favorite term?
I'm not going to lie. I said it, and I was just taking a guess. Inspiring, disgust, and loathing, repugnant. So, yeah, I did use it right. Okay, good.
Yeah. No, abhorrent. You did.
I just want to make sure. Yeah, no, I just confidence. You know what I'm saying? No one questions it that way.
Well, yeah, disgusting. You know, that's what the losers should be. It is so disgusting. So I liked it. And so for my next loser... You know, and I was debating on this one, Charlie, because this was like sometimes when something is so disgusting, to get back to our term, like you think, okay, well, that was at the expense of somebody's success. Like, say someone lets up 10 homers in a game. Well, someone hit 10 homers in a game, you know, in the game of baseball. So, you know, how do you judge what? So this was a hard one for me, if it should be a winner or a loser, but I'm erring on the side of a loss, and that's why this is my second loser. So, and it's Norfolk State. So VMI, Virginia Military Institute, Charlie, they just swept Norfolk State, right?
Yeah.
This past weekend, as they prepare for Virginia Tech, and then they start SoCon play at Wofford, then they play UNC Greensboro. So they've got a tough schedule coming up, to say the least. So VMI is currently 13-8. They went 16-40 last year. So they were not a good team last year. VMI wasn't, but they're off to a 13-8 start. And that's what it looks like right now after, again, they swept my loser in Norfolk State. But that's not why we're here. We're here because on Sunday Funday, VMI got the sweep over Norfolk State. And it was the second mercy rule of the series to close out the sweep. They won 15-4. And also in the first game, they won 14-4, both of which went seven innings. Norfolk State is now 3-15. So, Charlie, you're probably saying, okay, a solid team is beating a terrible team, 3-15. Yes, but the point is, in the series finale, Norfolk State allowed 14 stolen bases. How do the pitchers allow 14 stolen bases in a seven inning game? Like, that's some little league stuff.
No, really.
And so VMI are dogs on the base paths. They've stolen 92 bases in 21 games this year. But to steal 14 in a seven inning affair, I mean, that's bad. And to add insult to injury, and I hate doing this because the Northeast Conference is cool, but before this weekend sweep, Norfolk State lost 34-1 against William and Mary last midweek. So still last week, they lost 34-1 to William Mary and then got swept by Virginia Military Institute, where they allowed 14 stolen bases in the series finale. And the pitchers, well, they struggled in that midweek as well. 34 runs allowed. They walked 20 batters in that game as well. So in the same week, a pitching staff allows 14 stolen bases and walks 20 guys in a 7-inning affair. So I don't know how to, I mean, that's tough, Charlie. That is very tough and disgusting from that pitching staff.
Yeah. To use another word, I would just simply say yuck.
Yeah. I mean, that's yucky. 20 batters walked or 14 stolen bases surrendered. Which one is worse? I don't know.
You know, those catchers are pissed with the 14 stolen bases. That's a tough look.
Boy, and the walks. They got a squad back to 34 runs. Dude.
It's one of those games where you're just praying it's over. You know, you're picking daisies out there, just waiting for the game, waiting for those outs.
Yeah.
My second loser, once again, not as abhorrent as that one was. It's Ole Miss. They got swept by Vandy, as we know, because Vandy was one of your winners, as they deservedly should be. Listen, it's not that big a deal. Like, it's just you lost to a good team. It happens. Just one of those things you'd love to get out there, especially in the SEC, and get that kind of win. But what adds insult to that injury is they had dropped their midweek to Jacksonville State on that Tuesday, March 14th. So now on a 4-game losing streak with Ole Miss, they now have coming up next today as we're recording, they got Arkansas Pine Bluff. That should be a win. But after that, the next 4 games are No. 3, Florida, followed by the next on March 28th, they play Southern Miss. So that's some really good baseball they got to win. And if they lose another series, it's just a tough way to get out there for Ole Miss to start the year.
Yeah, it is. I mean, their offense is great, but we'll see if that pitching staff can't rebound. You mentioned Ole Miss and Florida, a top 15 matchup, but there's there's a top 5 matchup at the SEC this week. Stay tuned. Later on in the show, we'll make our picks for those series. But yes, I like that. You put them in the loser category because there's concern, and I think primarily the concern is the starting pitching. I know the offense was held down by Vanderbilt's pitching, but you're confident that offense can carry you to heights, but I think that team's going to go as far as the arms take them. And obviously the injury to their ace is certainly something that still, I think, is what you try. I mean, you can't recover from that. You really can't. You can try to overcome it, but to fully recover from that, you just have to find ways to be better. And so they're trying to figure that out as well right now. For my third loser, it's, well, something that happened in a long baseball game. Charlie, I've mentioned 7-inning affairs and mercy rules all across the board. Well, this was a double that. 14-inning affair. Wichita State lost in 14 innings to Creighton over the weekend. 13-6 was the final score. Creighton scored 8 runs in the top of the 14th. I mean, Wichita State was shoving the entire game.
Yeah.
They used 10 different pitchers and struck out 20 batters. So that's why Wichita State's my loser, for allowing 8 runs in the top of the 14th after you had used 10 different pitchers to strike out 20 batters. You struck out 20 guys. Creighton strikes out 20 times and wins. That's a loss for Wichita State, in my opinion, there. And also, to add more insult, Charlie, of the 8 runs that were scored in the top of the 14th inning for Creighton, 4 were unearned. 3 errors really hurt the cause right there in extra innings in the top of the 14th. Plus, you strike out 20 batters as the staff and use 10 arms. You think you're winning. Nuh-uh, not the case. And so the errors hurt. And overall, at the end of the day, it's Creighton who does it. Wichita State did bounce back, though, and mercy rule Creighton the next day. But still, that's why it's a loss for me. You go 14 and throw the kitchen sink at them with dogs on the mound and lose. So
yeah, that's just tough. It's a bad taste in your mouth right there.
No doubt.
My last loser, similar to the Ole Miss scenario, but I would say Wofford Terriers. They went 0-4 on the weekend, lost all their games to Xavier, which hurts too, because the fact that they're supposed to go to Xavier and instead Xavier had to switch and then travel there, you think maybe that's a little edge for the Wofford Terriers. Clearly was not. So they lost to Georgia, then dropped the series to Xavier, and they now next have Georgia Tech today as we're recording this. Obviously, there'll be a result by the time this is out. But we'll say Wofford's still a very good team. Wofford Terrier fans, don't worry about it. You guys have a beatable opponent. But I guess now watch out for the stolen bases of VMI, but that's who they have next week. I think Wofford will bounce back, but, you know, just a bad look for a team that hadn't lost since the first game of the season.
Yeah, they had rattled off 14 straight wins until losing over the weekend to Xavier. And you're right, tough look when you know, they say, no, we're coming to South Carolina because of the weather. And
yeah,
Xavier comes, says, we'll be road dogs. And that's what they were. Speaking of dogs, you ready for weekend rotation time?
Absolutely, brother.
All righty. Friday night, who you got?
We're going to go with the Gardner Webb Bulldog himself, Bobby Alcock. 8 innings pitched, 3 hits, no runs earned or otherwise, 2 walks, 12 Ks on the year, 29 and a third innings pitched, 2.45 ERA, which is fantastic, 38 strikeouts to 15 walks. I mean, that's what you call good outing.
38 strikeouts and 15 walks?
For the season, sorry. That's for the season. 12 strikeouts and 8 innings for the game on
that,
3 hits.
That's like, no, I knew what you meant.
Yeah.
But that is unbelievable. Yeah. And first, the name is unbelievable.
Great name.
Second, the team, Gardner Webb. I like there. I like how we get love from their program.
Yep.
But that's a great effort right there.
Yeah.
To be able to do that. I love that. And speaking of great efforts on the mound and great results on the mound, my Friday night guy also finds me going to the slab, and it's a team we've talked about, but I think this guy needs his own night in a special book right now. And it's a young man by the name of Hunter Owen, the Southpaw from South Portland, Maine, who had a complete game shutout against one of the best offensive teams in the country. Hunter Owen goes a complete game shutout, 9 innings, and he just allows 2 hits, no runs, 11 strikeouts in 1 walk, complete game shutout with 2 hits allowed and 11 Ks. I mean, he was doing things on the mound, and that is scary when you know you also have Carter Holton in that rotation. What Absolutely. A punch they have. The left-handed junior Hunter Owen, he is a fierce competitor. If you guys get a chance to watch him pitch, I mean, this is a guy you want. I mean, he is big time. So far this season, he's just been really good. I know you gave some season numbers, so I'm going to do it too.
Yeah,
28 and 2, thirds tossed, and he has a 2.2 ERA in 5 starts. So he's been fantastic in that Vanderbilt rotation, and he was at his best yet against Ole Miss over this past weekend with a complete game shutout.
Yeah, he's a dog. He's been big for them all year. Hunter and Holton are going to be just dogs for them all year, and that's such a big advantage that Vanderbilt has over other teams. Like, it's just such a massive win.
Right. It makes you think, like, okay, 1-2 punches are important, I think, because that's how you can win series. 1-2-3 punches is, I think, how you can win
World Series.
And 1-2-3-4 punches, really, like LS, like a team that, like, when you get into the double elimination of a bracket,
yeah,
and you have to throw a guy who might be your closer, like Georgia Tech did with Maxwell last year, like, you have to have that depth. Vanderbilt has that because the bullpen is so good.
Yeah.
But the only thing I brought up is you bring up 1-2 punches, and I think of Sproat and Caglione. I think of Burns and Dahlander. I think of Carter Holton, and I think of a young man by the name of Hunter Owen. I think those are the top 3 1-2 punches in the league. And when you go 1-2-3 punches, it's like hard. It's probably, you know, you add in Burns and Beam, you add in Waldrip and Caglione to Sproat. Like, there's some great rotations. Vanderbilt's is very good. And if Owen can pitch like that, Vanderbilt will be unbeatable.
Yeah, absolutely. I totally agree. Like, they're going to be so fun. And the great thing I like that Aria pointed out last week too is a lot of these Vanderbilt arms are sophomores, so they got another year, which makes them scary next year.
Well, they
speaking
might
of scary though, this same school did not do well in the tournament here, unfortunately, with their very popular pick for upsets this week. But we're gonna go to Oral Roberts, Tulsa, Oklahoma. So my Saturday guy is Matt Hogan. On the weekend, he went 11-for-21 with a double, a triple, 3 homers, 18 RBIs, and a 6.48 wOBA. So on the year, though, he's second on the team with a 351 average, second on the team in OPS with a 1,127, first in the team in homers, first in the team with homers. Let me check real quick. Yeah, first leading the team in homers with 8, and also a team leading 34 RBIs on the year. He was going ballistic this year, and also I just want to give props to his teammate, too, because I thought about putting them both on here because he's also a dog. But the guy who's hitting better than Matt Hogan on the year is his teammate Jonah Cox. 466 batting average. His OPS is 1,159. 41 hits on the year, Will, and 88 at-bats. I mean, that plays.
That plays. That's
a D-O-double-G. That's a dog.
That's a dog. Yep, that is. That is. I mean, just like you talk about Gavin Casas of South Carolina hitting balls out of the park, or a Brock Wilkin or a Jack Caglione, we got to give love. Yes, sir. We got to give love right there. I love that. That is awesome. And speaking of dog, I'm going to give some love to somebody you might not have heard of, Charlie. It's Ben Nemavant right there in his fifth season at Pacific, Charlie. And he turned heads a couple weeks ago. He had a six-hit performance at New Mexico State in early March. And some people said, wow, six hits in a game, you're doing something right. And he was. And now he's had 13 hits over the last four games. He was a dog this past week with a seven-hit weekend at San Diego. He's having a breakout year in his fifth year, Charlie. 36 hits in 42 games as a junior. He had 42 hits in 44 games as a senior. And now he has 37 hits in 18 games in his fifth year. After his first 2 years, he hit below the Mendoza line at Pacific. What? I love that story. And he's right now, you talk about dogs. I mean, you talk about Dylan Cruz. You talk about Ben Nemavant, the third and then fourth leading hitters in the country in terms of batting average right now. And I think that's how you say his name, Nemavant.
Would make sense to me.
And Ben, I will say this to you, Ben, you're playing really well and we're recognizing it. He's the fourth leading hitter in the country in terms of batting average. He's on a tear and he's continuing to play well. And it's a breakout season for him. No, I mean, no statistics from the years past would tell us that he was going to be doing these things. Maybe like you expected Dylan Cruz to hit above 500, but he's playing really well.
Yeah. We all love a late bloomer though. So props to Ben. Someone that's not a late bloomer. He's been a guy on the scene for a year or two now, but we're going to talk about Brandon Sproat, Florida. We all know who he is. Well, all he did was a complete game shutout over the weekend. One hit, obviously no runs of any kind. Only two walks, 11 Ks. He's been the ace for Florida. He's been a very good staff this year. We're just talking about 1-2 punches of him and Caglione. Hurston Waldrop, who's got a 4-year right now, but he'll get that down. So really, it's a 1-2-3, which I would agree with, like you were saying. On the year, though, 29 and two-thirds innings pitched. 2.73 ERA, 43 Ks to 14 walks. And Will, you wrote a great stat on here. I'd love to tell the people about it.
Tell them.
Dating back to April 29th of the last year, 2022, when Brandon, I always want to call him Braden for some reason, but when Brandon Sproat took over for Florida in the Friday night role that he was facing Kentucky, he's made 11 starts since then, is 9-0 with a 2.08 ERA, 76 Ks to 25 walks across 69 and a third innings pitched. And Florida is 11-0 in those starts. And Sproat also is averaging 6 1/3 innings per start during that span. So that's props and hats off to Will for that stat. But that's a great one. Just shows you how good he's been over the last almost close to a calendar year.
So he's made 11 starts since he's been the Friday night guy. And if you're the Friday night guy, you're the dog.
The guy.
You walk around Gainesville's campus and they say, that's our Friday night guy.
Oh my God, look, it's Brandon Sproat.
That's what I'm saying. That's our ace.
That's our boy.
And here's what he does, Charlie, that I love so much.
He
throws 100, confirmed. I mean, he's sitting upper 90s as a starting pitcher. You just mentioned the stat. You want to talk about longevity? He average goes into the seventh inning every single time. And they haven't lost a game that he has started since he's been the Friday night guy. Florida is a team right now, Charlie. They are a team. That's what I'm telling you.
They are.
And you got the Ohtani of the SEC. You've got, you've got it. You got Hurston. I mean, that's impressive. But you mentioned the ERA. And whenever I think of ERA, my eyes just... I got to like look closer at the screen to realize Paul Skeens has a 0.59 ERA right now.
Paul Skeens
through five starts.
Yeah.
I mean, he's allowed two earned runs through 30 innings in five starts. Yeah.
It's ridiculous.
But no, and he's struck out at least 11 guys in every start. At least. Yeah. I mean, he's had 13, he's had 12, but at least 11.
And the last thing I'll say about Sproat too. With the fact that you have your Friday guy going into the seventh inning every start is so big because that saves you so many arms for games in the Saturday and Sunday games where you're probably going to need to deplete the bullpen a little more quickly. So being able to save those guys from the Friday start and be able to use them those last two is such a big advantage for Florida.
Yeah, he's a great pitcher. Like he you talk about 9-0 with a 2.0 ERA through 11 starts, and we're talking like that's mainly SEC play from last year, and then this year, like he's just been great through big games, and him and then Caglione and then Waldrop. I don't know. I mean, it's going to be hard to beat that rotation. You know, it really is. That's one of the best rotations in the nation, and that's a fact. Speaking of rotations and speaking of arms and speaking of dogs, how about Matt Dablas of Oregon? He is my Sunday guy, if we want to go in sequential order of, you know, our three biggest stars of the weekend. Friday was Hunter Owen. Saturday was Ben. I think his last name's Nemavon. And then Sunday is Matt Dallas of Oregon. He's a relief pitcher for them through seven scoreless innings over three appearances last week. And he was so clutch, Charlie. When a reliever comes into the game and you're losing, it's kind of a unique situation because you just have to say, well, keep them where they're at. And that's exactly what he did here in Oregon. Series clinching win this past Sunday. He tossed four scoreless innings to help the Ducks rally from a 7-3 deficit. That was the deficit when he entered the game. He retired like 12 of his first 14 batters. He was just absolutely shoving. Oregon's 11-7 right now. They just picked up a series victory over Washington State. But look at some of the teams they've played. And they're 3-3 in Pac-12 play, 11-7 overall, which isn't great, but let's provide some context.
It's workable. You can work with that.
I think it's impressive for the schedule that they've played.
Okay.
Because when you look at this, Charlie, UC Santa Barbara has been on their schedule.
Fantastic.
Great team. Xavier's been on their schedule. You know how good they are after they just swept Wofford.
Big win.
San Diego's on their schedule. UCLA, a top 25 team, I mean, is on their schedule. And their past opposition, so the teams they've played, when you combine the record of every single team they've played so far this season, 193 wins and 75 losses. That's a 717 win percentage against the past opposition they've played. That's the toughest schedule they've played in the nation so far based off past opposition win percentage. And they're workable right now at 11-7 and 3-3 in Pac-12 play. But Matt Dallas, I mean, he's been really impressive. He's a weapon kind of out of the bullpen for this team. He hasn't allowed a run in five straight appearances and has a 1.65 ERA and 16 1/3 out of the pen this year. So Dallas is my Sunday guy, and just a little bit of extra information on Oregon for those that cared.
Yeah, who doesn't love Dallas on a Sunday, you know?
I guess Cowboy fans.
Yeah, exactly.
They don't love them. I wouldn't love them if I'm a Cowboy fan because they've sucked lately, haven't they?
They do.
Well, in the postseason, right? Yeah. You know,
we like Matt Dallas. That's what really matters.
Yeah, we do.
Another thing too is same with any kind of pitcher, you know, like we're talking about how big it is for starting pitching to go late in games though. But having a guy like a Matt Dallas, especially with a weekend like this over seven scoreless innings over three appearances, it's just one of those things where like it's great to have a guy when you can hit the oh shit button, and this guy, a guy like Matt Dallas, can come in and just shut the door down and keep you guys in the game still. Obviously, the offense still has to produce runs in those, but the fact that your relief pitchers are keeping you competitive in it is a huge advantage.
Yes, and I think that it's interesting when you talk about shutting, because some guys shut the door.
Yeah, he held the door open, I guess, for the offense.
Yeah, and then some guys hold the door open. And then some guys, you know, they lock the door. They get the key, but it's like if Yo-Yo Morales is coming, he might break the door down.
Yeah,
you know, Dylan Cruz might break the door down.
Yeah.
But then when the dogs come out there, like a Walters, they're slamming the door completely shut.
Absolutely.
They don't give a dang. They're kind of putting boards up on the door like you're not getting in.
Zombie apocalypse type stuff.
Exactly. So That's interesting. I love that analogy in the game of baseball. When a closer comes in and they come in and slam the door shut, that's one of my favorite terms in baseball, because you just is like, okay, he's getting a save, and a save is a beautiful statistic because you can either get, you know, an out in a ninth or just throw the last three innings of the game, whatever fits your what you want to do. So
absolutely.
How about this one, Charlie? Series picks. This is
got
one
some
of the
bangers.
Best yet. Best yet, I think, when you talk about we had so many bangers, we still couldn't fit all the bangers on here.
Yeah.
So let's do it, man. Should we at least tell the fans that are keeping score at home where we're at right now in the current
I can pull it up.
Series rankings after last week? I had an okay week, you could say.
You had an okay week. You went 5-0, I believe, so props to Will. Clap it up for Will.
Yeah.
I unfortunately went 2-3. I had some bad misses, but that's okay. So now on the year, Will, you are 13-7. I am 11-9. So it's still pretty close.
It's a battle right now. It is an absolute battle. You had a 5-0 week 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
I had a 5-0 week last week. So the midweek podcast is where you need your picks.
We're killing it, man. No one's had an 0-5 yet this year, which is good.
And I had, I think, some last year. So
I think I had one, though, too. We're all guilty of it one time or another.
Yeah, but this year, we're having success with the picks. Both have winning records. Absolutely. Both have had 5-0s, and we're both picking tough series. And let's start with this.
We're the SEC of picking ball games.
Yeah, we could be.
Speaking of the SEC.
Yes, it's Mizzou in South Carolina.
Yep.
Number 22 Mizzou at number 11 South Carolina. You put it down in here, Charlie, the battle for Columbia.
Indeed.
As the team from Columbia, Missouri travels to Columbia, South Carolina. Two top 25 teams, two teams who are red hot. Who do you got?
Well, I'm going to guarantee that the school from Columbia is going to win. But the Columbia I think is going to win is the South Carolina Gamecocks. It's Mizzou's hot right now. I'd probably choose Mizzou against, like, if they're playing a Kentucky, when Alabama or Auburn or one of those schools right now. But the fact that South Carolina might be the hottest team in the country, I'm going to keep going with them. I think Will Sanders is going to start clicking eventually, and maybe it's this weekend.
I think he will. He's going to click. I think that, and he's going to be crucial. I mean, they don't need anything else to click. They've been so good this year, 20-1. When I look at Mizzou, when I look at their rotation and what they're going to do, they've had mixing and matching all season long with Tresser, Murphy, Lozy. Yeah. I mean, it's a nice rotation. Franklin's a great weapon. Yeah. Maltrud has been humming out of the bullpen. It doesn't matter. I feel like even if Sanders is excellent with that sub 2.5 ERA that South Carolina has, you look at what they do. They just beat Beam, Dallander, and Burns. Who can't they beat?
True, that's fair.
And so I'm picking Mizzou to win on the road. They've won 5 in a row. They're 16-3. And I'm going to rock with the Tigers, but it's going to be tough. We've heard it from many different sources that South Carolina is one of the toughest places to play in America. Yes. From two different people on this podcast, Bethune-Cookman head coach Aria, they both said they love that facility. Yeah. So we're going to find out. South Carolina's been hitting the ball out of the park. I know we have a top 5 matchup and we have another top 15 matchup and a top 17 matchup, but this is the matchup that I'm most excited for. Maybe because we have that Mizzou and St. Louis bias, but
yeah.
I think that this is a huge series and I'm going with the Tigers of Mizzou.
That's fair. I think you made a great point with the fact that obviously South Carolina has a great staff, but you can say that Tennessee is the better one and Mizzou just did take it to Tennessee this last weekend. I'm excited for this one. This was probably my favorite one too, because I have not got to watch a ton of Mizzou yet this year, and so I'm going to be very excited to watch them this weekend for sure.
Yeah, Mizzou's been on the rise. I hope we can continue to have D1 baseball podcasts on the midweek podcast, as we will, but I hope that the conversations continue to warrant the talk of Mizzou, because absolutely. We are fond of that program. We've spoken with a player from their program last season.
Shout out to Austin Cheeley.
Exactly. So I'm looking forward to this one, but South Carolina has been so good. I mean, so it's going to be a challenge. And I would not be surprised if South Carolina sweeps. I really wouldn't. That's how good they've been.
Also, South Carolina South Carolina is undefeated at home so far this year.
Yeah, they're damn near undefeated on the year. I get it, but they're just a great team. And I would not be surprised if they sweep, but I'm just saying I'm picking Mizzou because they're hot. They just come off a Tennessee victory, and I think that they can ride that momentum to somehow get 2 of 3. I don't know how they're going to do it, but I think they're going to do it.
How high would they shoot up the rankings if they beat South Carolina?
I think you'd have to put them inside the top 15.
Yeah, I think so.
And after back-to-back, it depends if they sweep or if they get
three.
If they sweep, they you got to argue for top 10. You really do. At back-to-back weekends, back-to-back. So you look at body of work, what they did at the beginning of the year is now matching up to sweeping Tennessee and sweeping South Carolina. I don't know how you wouldn't be top 10. Or at least in that vicinity, but I don't think they're going to sweep.
It should at least be a conversation if they somehow swept, you know?
Yes, I hope we can have it. But again, I think that if anybody gets the brooms out, it's probably South Carolina.
Yeah.
But I think that Mizzou's going to find a way because they're a tough group of guys. If it's a close battle toward the end, I'm picking Mizzou. Look how many, if anybody looking at Mizzou, look how many walk-off or like late games they've won. They've been really clutch in the seventh, yeah. eighth, and ninth. It's and true. That's why I'm picking them to grind out a couple victories. So
that's a fair point.
Now we move on to Texas Tech at Texas. This is a fantastic series. This is a really, I mean, there's some really good series this weekend. 14th ranked Texas Tech traveling to unranked Texas. But Charlie, I don't think that they're going to be unranked for long. And I was reading that right? They're outside of the top 25
yes,
right now.
You are correct in that.
So I don't think that will be the case for too much longer. Then I think Texas, ultimately, I'm going to go first on this one. They get it done at home. I think they're going to start off big play, Big 12 play well. I mean, Lucas Gordon hasn't allowed a run in his last two starts. David Shaw and Charlie Hurley are nasty out of the pen. Texas is hot. They're winners of 10 straight. And I think that they're going to get the job done against Texas Tech.
I'm taking Tech for a couple of reasons. I think they're a better team. Also, not that I'm not usually one to fault teams for their schedules, you know, but I guess I'm saying more wary of the, if you look at Texas, the Longhorns schedule and how they've won, like you say, you go on a win streak like that, it's for sure good. But like the teams they've beat, New Orleans, North Dakota State, Manhattan, Mercer, Sam Houston, they lost a series to Fullerton, though. That's the first solid team they played in a full series. They've also lost to LSU this year. They've also lost to Vanderbilt, Mizzou, and Arkansas. So all the real talent teams they played, they've lost to. So that gives me a little bit of a...
Yes, Texas struggled early on. Now they're on a 10-game win streak, and you make a great point. The 10-game win streak isn't against the teams that they played early on when they struggled. They struggled early on because they're playing very talented teams that beat them. And they played in some close games that they just lost, and now they're when you can string together wins in the game of baseball, no matter who it is, I think that's confidence. I think you make a great point, though. I really do. And when I'm going to bring up records and talks, we have to talk about Texas Tech is 18-4. Yep. You know, they started off conference play in Big 12 play. They just got a victory at home against number 12 Oklahoma State this past weekend. They took 2-3 against Oklahoma State, including on the Sunday game, getting a mercy rule win 12-1 in 7 innings, and they won in 10 innings and with a walk-off victory on Friday. And that was against the 12th ranked Cowboys at the time last weekend. Texas Tech, a ranked team, very much deservedly so, Charlie. One thing that concerns me, and I'm going to kind of be a little bit of a hypocrite later on in the picks, but one thing that does concern me is this is a Texas Tech team who's 17-2 at home, 18-4 overall, and 1-2 on neutral sites, but they've yet to play a road game. Going to Austin seems a little bit like a tough challenge for your first road tests.
It's fair.
So we'll see.
But I too will be a hypocrite then for the next, or not the next game, but the game after that we'll talk about.
Yeah, I'll be a hypocrite.
The second one, this third game of the series. Well, we got a banger here too. 17 Miami at number 2 Wake Forest. I'm taking Wake Forest. I think just the fact that they edge out Miami in the pitching, there's a better hitting team Miami. Obviously, like CJ Cavis, Yoyo Morales, those guys, absolute dogs. But like, I mean, Wake Forest has more dogs than the Humane Society.
They've got canines. They've got Rottweilers. I mean,
Shepherds. They got all of them, man.
Yes, they've got everything. The Golden Retrievers are even there when you need them. And the Demon Deacons I'm picking as well. The Demon Deacons are 18-3. They're 14-1 at home. You don't even need to look. When I tell you they're 18-3, you don't have to look at their splits. You know that they're both going to be pretty good. But overall, they won 2 of 3 against Notre Dame. They won 2 of 3 against Duke. And I think that they're going to win in Winston-Salem 2 of 3 against Miami. And then you were going to look up and say Wake Forest is now 6-3 after 3 weekends of ACC play and win all 3 of their ACC series. They've won their first 2 ACC series, getting 2 of 3, haven't got the sweep yet. And that's interesting because Duke and Notre Dame, they didn't sweep, and teams you think the number 2 current team in the nation should sweep, right?
Yeah.
Well, now Miami, that's probably the toughest, one of the toughest teams on their schedule really remaining. When you look at this series, Charlie, who is going to be a bigger challenge than, I think at Louisville might be one challenge later on in April, but I think that this is the biggest challenge left on their schedule as they continue to have SEC week, ACC weekends pile up. This is going to be a great series. Miami's played so well. Part of me wanted to pick Miami, but I just think Wake Forest is going to be able to get it done. Starting pitching, I think edge Wake Forest. I think the bats is nearly even in some ways, but overall, the power of the bats in that boombox of a ball, I think that there's going to be a lot of home runs this weekend. Miami just came off a game where they hit 7 home runs. Wake Forest hits more home runs than anybody could think of, 42 home runs in 21 games so far. Brock Wilkins got 13 of them already. I think this is going to be an awesome game. And Wake's a team that hits above 300 as a team. But I just think it comes down to this: Rhett Lauder, Sean Sullivan, Josh Hartle. I think that rotation's just going to be better than what Miami has to offer. That's one of the best rotations in the ACC. Sean Sullivan, again, opponents are hitting 111 off Sean Sullivan. Rhett Lauder, 196 opponents. So two of your starters are sub Mendoza allowing. Sub 200 is what they're allowing on the batting average. All their starters have sub 2 ERAs. It's the best starting rotation in the ACC. They have a 2.38 ERA as a team right now. So yeah. I'm going with Wake Forest. That starting rotation is awesome. And we didn't even talk about one of the better relief. We talk about the back end. I mean, what, Menachie? Or how did it go?
Manassee. I believe it's Manassee.
Manassee and Walters, two of the best back end arms in the ACC going at it. So that's going to be fun too. Walters of Miami and then Manassee of Wake, two guys that could get up to 100 about. So that's going to be fun. Sorry that was a long-winded answer.
Okay.
You know, I love the Demon Deacons.
You do.
I've got the hoodie on right now and I'm going to show you right here. You know, that's a Demon Deacon on the hoodie, Charlie. Right.
One of the most random mascots out there.
So that's why I had to talk about it. People are like, Will, shut up, and now I will, and we'll move on.
All right, next one, we've got LSU at Arkansas at LSU. I'm taking LSU, and like how you said, you worried about the fact that this is Texas Tech's first away series going to Texas. Same thing with Arkansas. Arkansas's done 18 games in a row at home, right?
Yes.
Something like that.
To start the year.
One, I think LSU is better. Arkansas is obviously on a roll right now. I think it's just also insanely hard to beat, and for anyone to beat LSU at LSU, it's going to be almost impossible. And I think there could be a little bit of, not rust, but, you know, first series away can always be a little bit challenging. So I think that will play in LSU's favor. But I do think ultimately LSU will win because I think they're the better team, and the fact that their home field advantage is greater than most teams.
Yeah, LSU's electric atmosphere. I was trying to convince myself to pick Arkansas and I just couldn't do it.
Yeah.
I really couldn't. And that's why I was about to be a hypocrite. But then
you changed
it up. The point of Arkansas going on the road the first time plays a factor. But also the point that Arkansas has won 13 consecutive games, I think, plays a factor in that. Can a red hot team do some things against the number one team in the country? I mean, these are two teams that I wouldn't be surprised if we see this matchup in Omaha, Nebraska. I really wouldn't. Number one LSU against number five Arkansas. Arkansas has got weapons right now out of the bullpen. You look at what Hagan Smith is doing. You know, he's coming out of the pen multiple times a weekend now. And then Jared Wagner is awesome. You know, you talk about Michael Turner in the rentals. What about
big
this guy?
Rental.
What about this guy from Creighton?
You know what it reminds me of a little bit? The back-to-back years, the Cardinals went Lance Berkman, then Carlos Beltran.
Yeah. I mean, that's what it is. And then you got Borfin. I mean, this Arkansas team's great, but LSU is better roster-wise. I mean, that's obvious to say. They're number one consensus in the country right now across every board. Like, it's LSU, and then there's a drop-off a little bit just because they're starting pitching so deep. Their bullpen's pretty deep, and one through nine they can hit, and they have probably the best player in college baseball as well in Dylan Cruz, but it doesn't stop there. And really, I mean,
they might have the best two players in baseball, him and Skeens.
him and Skeens. They've got the best hitter. They've got the best pitcher. And it's crazy because last year, the best hitter in college was Tommy White. And now he's on the same team as Cruz. So it's like, that's always going to be something I come back to when I talk about LSU. They've been so good this season, but I mean, this is a game that you guys got to watch. I mean, this is another litmus test for LSU. I think when you look at this, because when you talk about two of the best teams in the country so far, they're going to battle LSU 18-2, Arkansas 18-2. So let's get after it with this series, number one versus number five. I'm going to go with LSU though. And Skeens, like you said, I think that he's just going to get the job done and LSU is going to find a way to take two or three.
It's hard to beat Paul Skeens. Last series of the day though, number three, Florida versus number 13, Ole Miss. I'm taking Florida. I think the pitching can propel them because I think you could argue they're equal hitting wise to Ole Miss top to bottom. But they have better arms. So and they're at home too. So I'm taking Florida for sure.
Yeah. No, that's huge. And speaking of that, I'm going to take Florida as well because I think that the Sproat, Caglione, Waldrep is just too much. I think that Florida is a team that is their dogs, man. They're top five team in the country. I mean, that just shows you how good they are. Ole Miss is great, and it's tough to pick against Ole Miss, the reigning champs, in back-to-back weeks for me. But reigning champs, you talk about a team that was last in the tournament last year, last team in the tournament to win it all, to lose your ace, and then to lose swept by Vanderbilt to this weekend, you got to go up against Florida. That's a tough sequence of events because Florida – you're going up against two top five teams now that, you know, Vandy's moved inside there. Florida's there and back-to-back weekend. So it's going to be a challenge. There's no question about it. You're going to see gas. You're going to see great arms. You're going to see great bats. And overall, I think that the Gators are going to be able to get the job done. Josh Rivera is turning into one of the best hitters in the SEC. He's hitting .418 this year, Charlie, with 10 home runs. Like, we talk so much about Jack Caglione, 356 and 13 home runs and throw 100 and strike out the world. Josh Rivera is a guy that I've loved his game for a while, starting all 22 games, but he's hitting .418 with 33 hits, 10 homers through 22 games. So he's been great. Obviously, they have one of the best hitting catchers in the league.
Yep.
I'm a big fan of Florida. I am. And when you get two starters in Sproat and Caglione who have sub-1, not ERAs, sub-1 whips, you know, that's when it gets impressive. You know, Sproat with a .88 whip, he's 4-0. Caglione with a .95 whip, he's 3-0. Hurston's got a 4 ERA, but he's 3-1 in his own right. So I think that it's going to be interesting, man.
I agree.
Florida team's good, man. They're going to go on a run.
I'm glad you pointed out Josh Rivera because he is kind of one of these X factors for the team because he's having the year we thought he'd have last year. Like, I think it's fair to say, like, he was a little disappointing last year. I think Florida at times in general was, like, they had a couple of injuries. You know, some guys just weren't playing right. But the fact that he's playing, like, the way we know he can play, and like a true star in the making right now, like, I mean, he makes him so much more dangerous. And you're right. 10 home runs from the shortstop position this early in the season is something every coach in the country would take.
Oh, I mean, he hit 9 all of last year in 64 games. He has 10 in 22 games this year. And you're right. He hit .298 in 2020 in 16 games because it was 2020.
Yeah.
Hit .253 in 54 games in 2021. A little bit of a disappointment, but he had a great summer going into that year. He was a second team preseason all SEC pick for the 2022 season, and he hit .254 again. So pretty much .250 same average in 64 games and 9 homers. And then this year he's hitting .418 through 22 games, 10 homers. He's been a huge X factor. I mean, right now you'd have to say he's first team all SEC shortstop. I know that there's a guy named Jacob Gonzalez, but from a numbers perspective, I'm going with Josh Rivera right now for first team all SEC. Now, we've only played one SEC weekend. I get it, but that's, you know, that's something.
Yeah, it is. That's going to be such a good series. Florida's really looking like an absolute weapon this year.
They are. And overall, I think Arkansas, when you got a top five matchup, like, would you be surprised if Arkansas was able to take two of three? Or do you think, like, it's just LSU sweeping? Because Skeens...
No, I don't think it's going to be a sweep. It's hard. Because, like, here's the thing. Like, you're probably not going to be LSU on a Friday night. It's just not going to happen. Unless, like, Paul Skeens has to implode for it to happen, you know?
When Jay Johnson compared him to Steven Strasburg.
Yeah. Like, in Oh shit! Another
he's
coach.
Got a point. He's got like a point .5 ERA. Like that's what I'm saying. Like
There's another coach that backed him up on that statement. I totally blank on who it was. I'm pissed I can't think of it. But I'll send you the tweet. I'll tweet it out or something.
I mean, they were saying like this guy can handle pro hitters right now. He's sitting 99 and he's striking.
He's in the wrong baseball. You know.
Absolutely. I mean, he's dominant. He is dominant. And absolutely. I think that no one's asking about the bat now versus Paul Skeens.
No.
You know, this will play. Friday nights will play.
Imagine being that good that you're telling Paul Skeens, now we don't need you to hit.
Yeah. So that's going to be a series. All of them are going to be good. We can touch on some other series if you fancy it. Rutgers and UConn are playing this weekend.
It'll be a fun one.
Illinois and Nebraska are playing. It's a Big Ten action. Also, I think one to watch, and I'm not one that we're picking as well, Arizona State, always some rivalry. And then this one I think is going to be interesting. Number 23, Kentucky, longest win streak in the country at 14 games. Can they go down to Tuscaloosa and at Alabama? Yeah. Kentucky at Alabama. Kentucky now in the rankings after they've won 14 in a row. They've entered in this week. And at Alabama, what can they do? Alabama just dropped out of the rankings. Kentucky got in. And so that was the interesting part, Charlie, for the rankings. You had overall six new teams enter D1 baseball's top 25.
Yeah, a lot of shakeup. There's been a lot of parity this year so far, so I've been liking it.
Yes, the teams were number 16, Boston College, number 17, Miami, number 22, Missouri, number 23, Kentucky, number 24, West Virginia, and number 25, Grand Canyon. So those were the six teams that entered D1 baseball's top 25. Also, if you want to give any other shout outs as we wrap up the show, shout out to SLU. They're off to still a great start. They're 12-5. They won 2 1-run games over a team in Lamar who was 13-4 headed into last weekend. So SLU's performing well. Shout out to the Lou for that. Also, if you like D2 baseball, there's top 25 matchups in Springfield, Illinois, the state's capital, the next two weekends, UIS hosting UIndy and then Quincy. But I just had to say that to plug.
The game will be over since we're recording on Tuesday, but hopefully Team USA comes out with gold here in the World Baseball Classic final tonight against Japan.
That's been fantastic to watch. It's hard keeping up with that college baseball, the March Madness, but
good time to be a sports fan, though.
We pull out the screens when we can. So
darn right.
Again, we thank you guys so much for listening to the Midweek Podcast. We'll be back next week for more fun. We'll have a special guest on the way as well next week. So it won't just be me and Chuck. So appreciate you guys, and we'll talk to you. Enjoy some baseball this week, and we'll talk to you next week.
Are you working? What kind of work do you do?